Good morning. My name is London Breed. I am the District 5 Supervisor and President of the San Francisco Board of Supervisors. We are here again to talk a little bit about 420 and some of the consistent challenges we continue to experience as a result of this event. So we have one new change this year, so I just wanted to go down and talk a little bit about that, and then bring up a few speakers to talk about what their plans are. We have Phil Ginsburg here from the Rec and Park Department, as well as Captain John Sanford of Park Police Station and other city agencies, who will speak briefly in terms of their roles of what's going to happen at this particular, I guess, quote unquote, event tomorrow in Golden Gate Park. And as we know, every year on 420, about 15,000 visitors flood Golden Gate Park and the surrounding community for what is the kind of unsanctioned 420 holiday. Love it or hate it, the culturally historic 420 festival is not going away, and it has significant impacts on our streets, on our neighborhoods, and on our parks. Past 420 festivities have led to horrific traffic, overwhelmed residential streets, public urination, damage to public and private property, and strained police resources, and has had an impact on Muni and other park resources. And on the following day, 421, dozens of city staff members and volunteers have had to work tirelessly to clean up the parks and the surrounding community, collecting over 10,000 pounds in garbage. Since 2013, I've worked with these city agencies to execute a comprehensive plan to mitigate these issues. But cleanup, traffic control, and increased security came at a huge cost to taxpayers. That's why this year we're trying something different. I'll let Phil Ginsburg talk a little bit about what's the details of that relationship. But for the first time, we are partnering with a private sponsor to provide more infrastructure, safety services, and approved vendors. Our sponsor is Alex Aquino, who is owner of Black Scale, that's located in the Haight Ashbury community. He's been a leader in this community, a resident, and an active member of the Haight Ashbury Merchants Association. He has helped put together a number of events in the neighborhood, including the Haight Ashbury Street Fair, which has, it's an incredible event that happens along the Haight Street corridor. With Alex's involvement, there will be bathrooms, approved food stalls, medical personnel, a gated perimeter, and security, crowd control, and adult-only admission. There will be no drugs for sale, no unauthorized music, and no permitted concessions, and no alcohol. As always, there will be no tolerance for visitors who are using 420 as an excuse to damage our parks and our neighborhoods. This is still not a city-sponsored or approved city event, but with this new partnership and a well-oiled plan among city agencies, we hope this year will be cleaner and safer for everyone. And the point is, you know, in working with this sponsor, is to cut back on what the expenses are to the city and county of San Francisco, to our taxpayers. We're paying for police, we're paying for services, and this is the first time in working with a sponsor where we're hoping to help offset a number of those costs. And so I want to bring up Phil Ginsburg first to talk a little bit about the Rec and Park Department, how this is going to help with the expenses of the event and control some of the challenges that exist year after year with the Rec and Park Department. And then after that, I will bring up Captain Sanford to talk a little bit more about the security and what's going to happen in the perimeter and safety. And then we'll get to a couple of other city agencies, and then we'll answer some questions. So with that, Phil Ginsburg.
Thank you, Supervisor. I'm Phil Ginsburg, the General Manager of the Recreation and Park Department. And let me start off by thanking Supervisor Breed for not an easy task, but which is embracing leadership of what's been a challenging event for us for many years. This is an event that happens to us, and by the way, it's not unique to San Francisco. This happens in major cities all across the country in 420, and I think major cities are presented with a lot of the same challenges. Our goals for tomorrow, Today's only 419, but our goals for tomorrow are pretty simple. Most importantly, we want people to be safe, and we want to make sure people are safe. Two, we want to minimize the impact on our surrounding neighborhoods. And three, with particular emphasis from the Parks Department, we want to protect the park and keep it clean and protect the landscape. So, with Supervisor Breed's support and with an incredible amount of collaboration from city agencies that include Public Works, MTA, our police department, our fire department, our sheriff's department, our juvenile probation department, and most importantly, what's new this year, in partnership with this neighborhood, with this community, the Haight Ashbury neighborhood, we're trying something a little different. As Supervisor Breed did an awesome job of summarizing, we have a community partner that is going to help us to provide some additional services to achieve those three objectives, which is keeping people safe, minimizing impact on the neighborhood, and keeping and protecting the park. There will be fencing, which means that entrance into this space will be more restricted. We will have security guards at the entrances that will restrict people from bringing in glass, from bringing in barbecues, from bringing in amplified sound, from bringing in hard liquor. Most importantly, from bringing in kids under 18. Not happening, or at least we hope. Inside, there will be food trucks and there will be some sponsorship tables, but the revenue from those auxiliary services from our community partner is generating are going to be used for the following. One, they're paying for the fencing, they're paying for additional security, and they are supporting efforts, and I want to thank Taking It to the Streets for their neighborhood partnership. They are supporting our efforts to clean up afterwards. This is an event that is incredibly taxing on our neighborhood and our city staff, and specifically my department. Last year, it's actually not 10,000 pounds of trash. It's 20,000 pounds of trash that are removed from Golden Gate Park. We typically deploy somewhere between 30 to 45 operations staff. And last year, I think we had over almost 40 park rangers out there, Chief. And that doesn't even begin to touch on the resources that other city agencies are providing. So one thing is, even with this additional support, that additional support doesn't supplant what the city will be doing. The city will be doing what it has done last year and the year before. We will again have over 30 operations staff, park maintenance staff out there. And we will again have throughout the day 40 to 45 park rangers out there, working in very close coordination with SFPD, with Public Works, with MTA, with the sheriffs. And we will again, when the event is over, be out there cleaning up so that people can enjoy the park as they always do the next day. So let me just conclude by saying this. If you're common, please be safe, respect other people, respect the park. You know, you come, you bring stuff in, you take it out with you. You pack it in, you pack it out. And respect the neighborhood. I am very proud of my staff. I'm extremely proud and appreciative of Supervisor Breed for being willing to think about some strategies to manage this event in a way that will achieve healthier objectives. Government is sometimes a laboratory and you experiment. And this year we are experimenting with a different approach that we are actually quite hopeful will result in a healthier, safer, and cleaner event. Thanks.
Thank you, Phil Ginsburg. And one of the things I should also mention is there is expected to be more trash cans as well as more places to use the restroom, including here on Waller and Stanyan. There were porta potties there last year, and we noticed that a lot of folks were using them. And we really, because one of the things that is definitely challenging is having access for this many people in terms of facilities. And so we'll have additional porta potties, and we ask that people who are coming for this particular event actually use them. So with that, I wanted to bring up Captain Sanford, who is the captain of Park Police Station, who will talk about the role of the department in this particular on this particular day tomorrow.
Good morning. Thank you, Supervisor Breed. First, I would like to thank Supervisor Breed for her leadership in bringing all of the stakeholders together. I actually brought our assistant district attorney, Asha Jameson, along with me. We talked about whether or not we could get stalking charges against a supervisor, but we couldn't go there. But in all seriousness, the supervisor has just shown an incredible amount of vested interest in this. This is something that we have worked on basically since last year's 420, and the supervisor has been extremely involved because she's concerned about the issues that you have already heard, but more importantly, the public safety for this community here. And that's obviously what I'm here to talk about, and that's the role of the San Francisco Police Department to make sure that public safety issues are addressed. And just like years before, we are going to do everything under our powers to make sure that those public safety issues are addressed. We know that bringing in 13 to 15,000 people to the Golden Gate Park, Sharon Meadows area, obviously is a great impact on this community. And so to address that, we have brought police resources. We are bringing police resources in from all over the city. We have resources that have been dedicated by the chief of police to make sure that we provide adequate police services to this event. We are going to have special forces out there to deal with issues that we anticipate that we are going to face. One of the main things that we are concerned about, and two of the key things that we are focusing on this year as a public safety department, is one, 420 is no event for children. We do not want children at this event. Children should not be at this event. And we have partnered with the Children Protective Services, and we will take enforcement action if necessary. The next thing is we have a concern in regards to vicious animals. I have Officer Crockett here, along with the Animal Care and Control, in partnership with them. Part of our strategic plan is to make sure that we address any vicious animal that can present a danger to the public. Phil Ginsburg just talked about the fencing around the area. We are concerned about people being within that enclosed area, especially with dogs that may be dangerous. We want to make sure that the public is protected to that end. So we will be policing for that purpose, and we will be taking police actions for violations that the officers and or Animal Care and Control observes during the 420 event. In regards to the overall event, we have our contingency plan in place. We believe that it's a good plan. However, we do know that there will be some issues. We do know that there's going to be some impact to the community. We will run a special command post, and out of that command post, we are going to have a hotline for our community to call into our command post for any quality of life issues. That's whether someone is urinating or defecating in your driveway, in front of your house, or any quality of life issue whatsoever. We want to be able to serve this community in the best capacity that we can. So we've purposely set up this hotline so individuals from this community can call in to address those quality of life issues. Of course, if it's an emergency, we encourage everybody to obviously call 911. We will have police personnel available on each side of the park, ready to address any public safety issue whatsoever. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Captain Sanford. And we just have two more speakers, but I wanna just thank Larry Stringer for being here from Department of Public Works, and also Recology, because they are responsible for helping to keep the neighborhood clean. They bring out crews of people, to do power washing and taking care of the streets. And we just wanna express our appreciation for the work that you all do to help make sure that the community stays clean. I also, one of the other challenges that we have is sometimes people's driveways are blocked, or sometimes there are some issues around parking control. And I wanna thank the MTA, and I think the Jeff Flynn is here. Thank you for the work that MTA is doing to make sure that we have a rapid response. So call 311 is going to be the correct. You want to talk a little bit about that and what people can do when there are challenges. There are also going to be some road closures and traffic redirections. And so we have Jeff Flynn and Jesse Schofield who are going to come and talk a little bit about those two issues. So.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. As the supervisor pointed out, our goal, and everyone else here has pointed out, our goal is to provide a safe and reliable transportation experience every day, and especially tomorrow on April 20th in the Haight Ashbury neighborhood and in Golden Gate Park. If people are having issues, we definitely encourage them to reach out to 311. For imminent safety problems, though, always call 911 with any public safety or emergencies that people may have out there in our neighborhoods. For tomorrow, we don't have any planned street closures unless there are issues that arise. We have reroutes in place to be activated if needed. We will have parking control resources throughout the Haight Ashbury neighborhood and in the park to safely divert pedestrians, bicyclists, and motorists around streets that may have become overcrowded with people due to the crowds tomorrow for April 20th here in Golden Gate Park and in the Haight Ashbury neighborhood. We do encourage riders of the 6, the 7 line, 7R, 33, 37, and 43 lines, those are Muni lines, to stay in touch at sfmta.com and follow us on Twitter to find out the latest on impacts to those lines. As I said, we don't have any planned reroutes at this point, but if needed, we will use police and our parking control resources to divert routes around the area, and we will have reroutes posted on our website and on our Twitter page. Our goal, again, is safe and reliable transportation for everybody. And to support that, we will be providing extra capacity shuttles in the neighborhood that'll be on standby in Golden Gate Park to fill in gaps in the service network. So if a gap is experienced on one of our routes in the afternoon, or if we need to move large crowds of people out of Golden Gate Park directly to Civic Center, BART station, and Muni station, we will have capacity shuttles available to do that. The shuttles will be staged on JFK Drive near Conservatory Drive. And like I said, they will express from the park to downtown, to Civic Center, BART, and Muni stations, and also be used to help improve the reliability of our transportation system in the Haight neighborhood to make sure our regular riders on the 6, the 7, 7R, 33, 43, and 37 lines are not overly impacted by this event. Again, if you have people have problems tomorrow, please contact 311 and we'd be sure to help you out. Also, we're gonna have units just like the police will throughout the neighborhood, monitoring service, monitoring conditions. So again, call 311 or go and see one of our units in the field. We'll be wearing yellow vests to help everybody out. Thank you.
Thank you. And I just wanna acknowledge we have Battalion Chief Perali here. She's gonna be in charge of the medical services in the area. And so thank you for joining us here today. Last but not least, we have from the Department of Public Health Emergency Preparedness and Response, Navina Baba. We have a comprehensive emergency plan, and you'll just touch briefly on that, and then we'll open it up to questions. So please come forward.
All right, thank you. So we do have a plan in place for any type of emergency, and we work very closely with our emergency medical service agency as well as the fire department to ensure that safety from a health perspective is always maintained. So we'll make sure to continue with that plan, and we have minute by minute understanding of what the EMS services are, if they're reaching capacity, what hospital services are, and if they're reaching capacity, and we can always plan for surges. The biggest message that we have is for everybody to have a safe issue, and it's really wonderful to hear the emphasis on not bringing children to this event, because that's where we see a lot of the marijuana poisoning and toxicity happening.
Thank you. And I just want to add. Oh, yeah, sure.
Yes, just to add to that, the fire department will normally deploy as needed. Also, with the fenced-in areas, we'll probably establish unified command at the command post and pick collection points. We have vehicles that are more scaled down if we need to get through crowds to evacuate patients. So we'll be coordinating with PD and all the other services. So we do like those evacuation corridors established so we can get patients out, and then we'll take it to see how the hospital status is. Thank you.
Thank you. And I just want to say that juvenile probation, they're not here with us today, but they every year continue to send out their probation officers and others to look for individuals that are underage who are part of their system. And we also try and work with the school district to get them to communicate with their schools about not coming to this particular event, and there will be challenges for those who are under the age of 18 with regard to this event, and we want to ultimately make sure that it is safe for all the attendees. We want to make sure that it has a reduced impact on our neighborhoods, and ultimately, as you can see, with all of these different agencies, we are a well-oiled machine, and I truly believe that this is probably going to be one of the most organized and best events yet because of our collaboration on trying to make sure that we keep people safe and we keep our neighborhoods clean. And when 421 hits, you may not even know that the event even happened. So that's our goal. And I saw Alex Quino, who is, I think, out there meeting with folks. He's the sponsor. He'll be available for questions. Thank you, Alex, for stepping up and, you know, just wanting to do something. And let me just add, Alex basically just said, I want to do something. I want to do something to take care of the community, to give back to the community. And he saw that this was a challenge, and he saw how expensive it was for the city. And so we appreciate what you've done and what you're willing to continue to do to help us make sure that we ease the financial burden on taxpayers for this and keep it coordinated and keep it as a safe event for all of the attendees in the surrounding community. So thank you for being here today. Yes. And with that, we will open it up to questions, if you guys have any questions. Yes.
You're offering bathrooms or perimeter security, medical care, but you say it's not a city-sanctioned event. How does that work?
Mr. Ginsburg, would you like to explain that?
Sure. There's no owner of the event. People just show up. There's no organizer of 420. There's no event promoter or producer of 420. So it just happens, and we know it happens, and this is an effort to be a little bit more prepared and to provide some of the health and safety services that, frankly, we know after years and years and years of having done this that we need. And so, thanks to Alex and members of the Haight Ashbury community who said, listen, we wanna help the city, reduce the impact on the park, keep people safe, and reduce the impact on the neighborhood. So that's what they're doing.
Pays for that?
Well, they're actually raising money by the presence. They have food trucks out there, and they've got some event sponsors, some of their partners that have agreed to step up to try to help make this better. So they are augmenting the amount of money that we already spend on this event. As Supervisor Breed said, we in the Parks Department spend about somewhere between 50 and 70,000 a year between park maintenance and park ranger overtime. SFPD has costs, MTA has costs, Public Works has costs. Every city agency that it's involved in this incurs some expense. So this is an effort by the community to help support the city and A, make it safer and cleaner, and also have some cost subsidy. Although I want to say again, they're not, this means more service. It doesn't mean necessarily, at least this year, less cost. We're going to be out just as we've been in the past, but we're going to be able to do some things that we were unable to do in the past to keep the event safer.
So is it accurate to say that the city does not sanction this event, but is trying to control it?
I think that that is perfect.
So in the past, though, it's been relatively laissez-faire comparative to what we can anticipate this year. If people push back and say they don't like that, what is the city's plan in dealing with that?
Well, let's take one day at a time, right? Where it's April 19th, let's focus on April 20th. And again, our objectives are simple, and anybody who, you know, is coming to this event with any sense of responsibility would agree with our event objectives. That is, keep people safe, minimize impact on neighborhood, and protect the park. That's it.
That's assuming a lot about the folks that show up.
Well, I think my hope would be that the vast amount of people that show up care about those things.
So it's also a $5,000 figure that you threw out. Was that for the entire city, or is that just...
No, that's just our department.
Do you have any sort of citywide figure?
It's the citywide figure. Each year what we're spending is estimated to be $100,000 to $140,000 a year. And that is kind of on the, based on the different city resources, because part of it is, for example, Recology has donated their services in the past. And so that has offset some of the cost over time. But again, it's still costing the city a significant amount of money.
What's the stance going to be about people smoking pot in the park, which is not legal under Prop 64?
Well, every single year the stance is it is what it is. We can't stop the people. I mean, we're talking about over 15,000 people. We can't stop everybody from smoking pot. I mean, technically smoking in the park is illegal. But we realize that, you know, this event, as I said, it's going to happen whether we want the event to happen or not. And so it would be irresponsible for us to do nothing. And that's what this effort is about, doing something and being realistic about what we should be focusing our energies on. All right, easy crowd. All right, thank you all so much for being here.